We have been trying to understand this basic fact in this course that computers in general have facilitated new ways of human action. And therefore, in this course, we are interested in studying those issues which have emerged primarily due to the use of computers. Some of this issue could have existed before computers also. But with computers, the intensity of the problem has increased. That's the reason why we are studying these issues in this course. Some of the fundamental characteristics of computers, that is the speed with which they work, the amount of information they are able to process in a very less time, their ability to store information for a long time, their ability to connect otherwise disconnected pieces of information, all these issues are giving rise to some new problems. Why we are calling them problems is because we don't know how to handle them. Our existing law, the way we were dealing with the world before computers, does not help us in dealing with these new issues. We don't know what to do. That is the problem here. Usually, whenever we have a problem, the first thing we do is, we try to see whether we have encountered similar problem earlier. If we have, and if we have solved it in some way, we will be happy to bring the same solution here and then solve it. If not, we try to see whether any similar situations were there earlier, how did we solve it, and then come and apply it here. This is a normal human practice. Law also works in a similar way. Law always looks for precedences, earlier judgment. And when a new problem comes for which we don't have an answer, we try to look for answers first in our earlier action. If we can't, then we try to apply a law. I have said in my previous lectures also, the first intuitive action among humans when they face something new is to resist it, to block it, legally to ban it. You try to ban it. Now, is this a problem? Just ban it. If we can't, see what has caused the problem? Technology has caused it. So the first reaction is ban the technology. The second usual reaction is, can we use technology itself to solve this problem? Can we use technology to solve the problem caused by technology? These are the two often used solutions. See, what happens in everyday life is, if there is something new, initially everybody would want to use it. And initially, because people have not used it for a long time, we do not know its potential problem. Only when people begin to use it for a long time, people will say this is a problem. And then they will start looking for one more solution. That one more solution will again initially be accepted, because the old problem is not there. Let me give you an example. Initially, humans had only one way to move from one place to another. They would walk or run, whatever it is. They would use their body itself to move. Then they found that riding on a vehicle is good, on a animal is better. So they used horses. Next came horse carriages. It was well established that if you are a rich person, then you would have your own horse carriage. And in cities where there used to be more wealthy people, there were a lot many carriages. Instead of going in a horse, you individually going in a horse, you could attach a car with it, that is a carriage, and then for 3-4 people, better solution was that. It is recorded in history that there is a problem with this. After some time, the cities encountered a problem. The problem was with mounting amounts of horse dung. There were so many horses in the city. Every wealthy man wanted to use a horse carriage, and they were moving horse from one place to another, then horse dung was a huge issue. So big that in US they had an international debate on this issue on how to manage it, because there was associated medical problems and other things. Because there was huge dung flying everywhere in the city and diseases were spreading fast, they couldn't clean it fast enough. That meeting, it is recorded, was a disaster, it seems, because they could not come with a solution to that problem. So something which was useful for a long time suddenly became a huge problem. And that is when steam engine came in. And then people said, oh, this is the solution. No, it doesn't give us this problem, John. With steam engine, after steam engine came vehicles. And they said, yes, vehicles are still better. It can move to our roads. Initially, they were all greeted as non-polluting means of transportation. Not with the, with the respect to other solution. This was non-polluting. See, what are we discussing today? Today, we are branding vehicles as the polluting agents. Right? So, this cycle always continues. There will be one solution. That solution will be greeted. Afterwards, there will be a problem. People will try to sort out that problem. Either they will bring in a new technology, or they will formulate laws. Even with vehicles, how do we solve the problem? We try to make new laws, saying that this vehicle, this day, this road, this day, nobody should get a vehicle. Or you put huge parking fees. Or you make the vehicle cost so high that people cannot afford it. These are all legal measures to control vehicular pollution. Or you invest in technology. You try to see how to make such engines so that less pollution is there in the roads. So either making new law or bringing in new technology is always the time-tested solution. What I am trying to impress upon you is that individual actions and using education as a means to solve the problem is not given much importance. And in the long run, only these two things will help us. Not law, not technology. Individual actions and education. For any problem, these are the better long-term solutions. It cannot give you solution immediately. But in long term, they are the ones which we have to prefer. In the last lecture, we discussed why professionals have to be extra careful while dealing with things, because they have special knowledge. They are licensed by the society to give some special service. And they are restricted by the code of conduct. All these things we debated. One thing which was missing from the discussion was the relationship of the professional with others. That part is not covered in the textbook. That is why I didn't take it up. But you should know that this is one of the important aspects of professional. How should professional deal with different people in the society? How should professional deal with his clients, for example? There are many models. Let us take medicine because it's a strong profession. How should doctor deal with patient? There are multiple options. One is, the doctor can say, I know it better. So you should follow whatever I say. That is the doctor. This approach is called paternal approach. Paternal approach is the professional takes the decision for the client. The client can't question it because the professional says, I know it better. The other extreme is agency model. The client says what to do, the professional does that. For example, take the case of booking agent. The client says, I want this ticket to be booked in this time, this place, this way. The booking agent does that. He does not offer anything new from his side. He will not say, for example, why are you going so early? It is not good. You have to come so early, 3:30, you better take 5:35. He will not say that. He is not supposed to say that also. It is agency model. In the world of medicine, there is this great debate on which model should be followed. Whether doctors should listen to patients or doctors should do that thing which he considers as the best. This debate is ongoing debate in medicine. People say the middle ground is the best. You explain to your patient what are the different options and let him take the decision. For example, in case of the patient having cancer, say, and there are multiple treatment options available. You can either go to the chemotherapy, or you may go to surgery, or combination of that, or you could take more holistic approach. It is understood today that the doctor should give the necessary information to the patient, and the patient should be given an opportunity to have a say. That model, which is called fiduciary, people say is a better model. The same applies even for engineering. Many cases which I am discussing in tutorials, you should bring in this aspect also. Should the software engineer take the responsibility and do the things? Or should he do only that thing which his client asks? What if the client does not know? Isn't it the job of the professional to educate the client? All these questions come into picture. So we should be sensitive to this issue also. So the relationship of a professional with the society is a complicated one. It goes much beyond the code of ethics and other things. Relationships does matter. For example, what should be the relationship of an employee with the employer? You are working in the company. What should be the relationship? What should be your relationship with your company? And what is the role of loyalty here? What does loyalty mean? Should you always remain loyal to your company? If so, what does that mean? How far can you stretch this loyalty? All these questions should come into picture. So, the issue should be broader. The issue of professional ethics should be broader to cover these issues also. But unfortunately, the textbook does not speak about this. So, we are somehow silent on this in our class. In today's lecture, I want to take up one issue which has emerged primarily because of the advances in computing. The issue of privacy. It is not that privacy is an issue which has emerged only after computers have come. The issue of privacy was there earlier also. What has happened with computers? This has come to forefront. But one of the survey which was done before some 3-4 years in India, it was observed that many people in India still are not concerned about privacy. Usually whenever one takes up this issue of privacy, the usual argument given is, why should you hide something if you do everything right? This is a normal argument which is given in the book. If you have nothing to hide, why should you fear? If you are saying, yes, privacy is required, yes, anonymity is required, that means you have something to hide. If the police comes and wants to search your house, you resist, the suspicion increases. If you allow police to come in, do the search and nothing comes out, then what? Will everything be okay? Would you allow police to come in? I mean, you have nothing to hide. You are a law-abiding citizen. Would you allow police to come in and search your house? They have found nothing. They will drink tea and then go out, say, after searching. Maybe if he is a good policeman, he can also say sorry. Will you be happy? Will you feel comfortable after that? Somewhat, I think most of us are not comfortable because from then onwards, every time when somebody wants to refer to a house, they will say, okay, that house, you know, that the police came to that house. That is how they will refer to us. They will not refer to that house as that house in the corner of the road or that house which has green paint. They won't refer to it. So permanently, that stigma, if we can call it so, will be attached. Even though nothing has come. So, is privacy important?
think general society has accepted that privacy is important. Even though we don't tell it explicitly, we do understand that privacy is important. Why is privacy important? What does it mean when you say you should remain private? See, there are two things. One is physical privacy. We understand, we call it as private homes, right? Public place and private home. Physically, everybody should have the right to remain private. What does that mean? That means that you should have that physical space wherein, in a very good sense, you can do whatever you want without fearing that somebody is monitoring you. What happens if somebody monitors us? Our behavior changes. The very feeling that somebody is monitoring us makes us change our behavior. There is this well-known phenomenon called as panopticon principle. Panopticon principle is primarily used in prisons. The prisons are constructed in such a way that, you know, it is constructed like this. There is this prison. Say it is like an oval. There are rooms everywhere. Okay? And there is this glass ceiling. There are prisoner rooms and there is a glass ceiling. In the center, there is this room for the supervisor. The catch is, supervisor can see all prisoners, but the prisoners can't see the supervisor. So the prisoners does not know when the supervisor is there or when he is not there. But there is this illusion that supervisor can come there anytime and he can watch anyone. This is called as panopticon prison. This is used very effectively in some of the prisons to minimize the security. If you create such a prison, the prisoners will have this burden in their minds that they are being watched. But when they are being watched, they do not. We are always facing this in our society today, right? We are living in a panopticon society today. The moment we step out of our house today, things are being recorded. It is a panopticon society. You don't know where the cameras are in the streets. The Bangalore traffic police, wanting to be equals in Bangalore being called as IT city, today have installed the cameras in all important traffic junction, and today you can go online and do the monitoring of those traffic signals. You can actually watch Bangalore traffic live through the cameras fixed in different places in the city. So there are cameras which are constantly watching us. The moment you go out, do some transaction using your cards, that is recorded. The moment you go out to have some entertainment, your physical evidence is there. Everywhere there is cameras in malls and everything is captured. Whether you make the payment there online, whether you have given the card, they are all recorded. The moment you go to your computer or mobile and do something there, it's all recorded. So, there is a case which is given in a textbook, The Diary of a Normal Man. You can see how this is actually true even in Indian scenario today. Whatever we do today is being recorded. Our actions, the things we do on a computer, the transactions we do, the calls which we make, the texts we send, everything is recorded. Should we fear? Or can we say, come on, I'm not doing anything illegal. I'm just calling my friends and parents and relatives. I have nothing to fear. Let them keep the record. Is that the case? The discomfort is there.
The discomfort is there. And the usual argument is, why should you allow somebody to remain private and anonymous? Who wants to remain anonymous? People who want to do bad things, they want to remain anonymous. Who will wear all those monkey caps when they come to bat? He should be a looter. That is why he does not want to be identified. He comes with a monkey cap. Ordinary people don't do that. So who wants to remain anonymous? Only wrongdoers. So should we give facility for someone to remain anonymous? No. There are software, most of you know, I need not say. People want to remain anonymous. Somebody does not want. How do we solve it? Take the help of technology itself. See, technology in one hand makes you feel that you are anonymous. For example, you may feel that you can create a fake, some email ID which does not resemble your name. Say, I am an Indian, 009 or 007 if you want, at something.com. Hey, my name is not there, so I am anonymous. I'll send email from this email ID. I'll remain anonymous. Is that the case though? It gives you that false sense of anonymity actually. In fact, this is not something only normal people believe. This is something even people in a very high profile job believe. There was this case recently, I don't know whether you follow. I don't know whether you should tell the name of the company. Okay, it's in public, so I can tell them. SAP Labs India. You know the case? SAP Labs India's one of the higher most person in that company recently was reported in public media that he was caught by the cyber police for sending anonymous mails to his own colleagues, not threatening or harassment. The case is like this: that executive, he saw something wrong was going on in his company. But he was the boss. He was the main boss. Somebody equal to him was mistreating one more employee and he saw it. Apparently he slapped the employee since he saw it. And he wanted some action to be taken against that person. He couldn't do it. So he was sending mails to his colleagues saying that please take action against him, please take action. And if you don't take action against him, I will complain to our bosses in Germany. Then these people came to cyber police and said, please, we are getting this mail from this mail ID. These are the contents, please trace. It's very easy to trace mails. And the IP was traced to his house. So he was sending mails from his house by creating a different email ID. So what I am saying is, even people at that position, if they can feel like that, whatever common people, they do feel. Technology creates this impression that you can remain anonymous, but really you cannot. In technology, the moment you press an enter key or press some key, there's always a possibility that this can be recorded, stored, tracked back to you. And more importantly, the problem with computers is this. Computers helps people to connect otherwise disconnect pieces of information. That you buy popcorn in itself is harmless. That you buy some dress in online shop and use your card is harmless. That you go weekly to the petrol station and fill petrol is harmless. If they are isolated, that you have taken loan in itself is harmless, these pieces of information. But what happens the moment you connect all of them? The moment you connect all of them, you get an image of a person. Okay, this is the person. He pays this much money for petrol every week. This person spends so much for entertainment every week. This person spends so much for his clothing. You get an image of a person. And because he can't manage all his finances, he has taken this much loan. So what you get is a complete picture of it, which otherwise we don't. This is the threat.
threat of information. And not only that, this information can stay forever. That I have got popcorn in a multiplex, if that information is stored, how long that information will be stored? Literally forever. And people can connect it. Imagine what would be the problem if something goes wrong. Mistakenly something happens. Mistakenly people, police identified me as a wrongdoer and they got arrest warrant against me and they put me in jail. But later it was found that I was innocent, I was free. If this information is locked, till I am alive, anybody doing search on me, this information will pop. Won't it hurt me? This is the issue. Two issues are, you can connect disconnected information and the information can live forever. How to build argument against this? How to say privacy is important? That we'll discuss in next part of this.